Good evening and welcome to the Danish Institute of Athens. I apologize beforehand because I have a cold. My voice, and I have now a glass of water. I'm hoping I will not cough all through your lecture. Tonight's lecture is part of a long-running commitment to the research on textiles in Denmark. I'm hoping that you've probably been here before for lectures co-organized with the Center for Textile Research in Copenhagen, which was previously run by Marie-Louise Nott and now currently by Eva Mons at the University of Copenhagen. In fact, we have another lecture on textiles in June, which will be presented by Marie-Louise Nott on the, let me get this absolutely correct, it is funerary textiles from Stamna in Etolia, today's co-organizers participated on this research project, and I'm given to understand there were some rather remarkable results, so I'm hoping to see you all here in June. Dr. Kaleomi Sarin, former Marie Curie Fellow at the Center for Textile Research, who is actually co-organizing Lena Bjerregaard's tonight's speaker's visit to Athens, will make the formal introduction of tonight's speaker. So please.
Oops. I have to say a few words about the now and the event today. Thank you very much, Christina, for inviting Lena and us, the city art team, to present this workshop tonight. And the lecture to give this lecture. We are very happy today to be benefited from the experience of an excellent weaver and scholar, specialized as only just a few people in the pre-Columbian textiles, a topic we hear very much about here in Greece, although we have a long tradition of ancient. Ancient weaving and traditional weaving, and we are not very much aware of this kind of weaving, which is very well spread in South America. The connection of this topic with the Greek culture and archaeology goes through the experimental path. We can learn very much through the study of the pre-Columbian textile cultures and apply to our interpretation of the ancient textile cultures of Europe and particularly of this region. In particular, weaving on the backstrap loom, the workshop we had before, is thought to be the earliest type of weaving. This kind of loom is probably the earliest type, which has not left traces in the archaeological record, so we very much experience about that. So a few words about our very good friend, Lena Bjerregaard. Lena has studied cultural history and conservation, and her dissertation was on the pre-Columbian textiles from the collection of the National Museum of Denmark. She has also studied Indian languages at the University of Copenhagen. She has worked many years in the Ethnological Museum of Berlin, and finds from this museum you're going to see in this lecture, where she was responsible for the conservation of this rich collection. In Denmark, she has worked as a research assistant at the National Museum of Denmark, where she was responsible for the conservation of the Peruvian textiles, in the Moscow Museum in Aarhus as a textile conservator, at the Center for Development Research as research assistant, and he has work also as a costume expert and a scenographer at the Odin Theater and the Bjorn Theater.
Yeah, and the hotel performer.
Okay. She has written many books and articles on this topic, pre-Columbian textiles, and she teaches all over the world this kind of looming, weaving with a backstrap loom and some other ancient textile techniques. So Lena, thank you very much for coming here. We're very happy to have you here in Athens. And this is a beginning perhaps for a long course. Many other courses that people here are going to continue as far as we understand. And we are looking forward to listening to you.
So thank you very much for inviting me. It's of course fun for me to come here and spend a week in Athens. And I know most of you because you were just in my course where I was very, very busy, and I'm sorry, but I hope you at least got an impression of what it is about. As you can see here, this is a contemporary picture of a woman from the Andes, from Chinchero, working on a backstrap loom. This loom, as Poppy said, is probably the first loom all over the world. I mean, it consists of four sticks, it's the most simple thing. Weaving was invented all over the world at around 5000 BC for some reason, and it developed from this kind of loom. I'm going to start with the ancient loom and things. Here, Peru. This is Peru. The many cultures, pre-Columbian cultures in South America, were spread out along here, the Andes Mountains, all the way down here for many thousand years, or several thousand years. And also up in Mexico, there was also a very rich pre-Columbian culture. But we have most of the archaeological artifacts we have from South America, from along the coast of Peru. This coast is the driest coast, is the driest desert in the world. The further south you get, the drier it gets. And as organic material survives forever, if there is no light, there's no humidity, and then we have it from there. In Mexico, we don't have very many archaeological things because of the climate that destroys them. Also in the northern part of Peru, there's not so many. But the further we get down towards the Atacama Desert, which is down here, the more things, organic material, is still intact. In this Andes region, there was no writing before the conquest. The conquest was in 1532, and people had other kinds of information, means of information. They had the Chimu, for instance. We cannot read the Chimu for some odd reason. Everybody sort of thought about studying that bravely, plus that it was 100 years after the conquest, it was considered blasphemic and they were all burned, and which of course ruined the whole infrastructure of the country because that is where they had their information in. There was also woven, some of the woven patterns also give some kind of information, but there was no writing. So it's very different from Greece. In Greece you have about none of the organic archaeological objects, but a lot of writings. Here we have a lot of organic archaeological objects and no descriptions at all. The descriptions come after the conquest. And this is from a book written by Ramana, who was an Indian guy who was taught by monks to read and write.
And he wrote 60 years after the conquest. He wrote a large manuscript. He wrote it because he wanted to send it to the King of Spain, Carlos V, in order to tell him how badly his subordinates were treating the native populations in Peru and South America. And during this, he described the whole Inca reign and all their customs. The Incas, of course, are only the last 100 years before the conquest. Before that, there were loads of other cultures for thousands of years, high cultures of Dai, of other high cultures that came in. The Inca, they were sort of like the Romans and like the Aztecs. They didn't bring much civilization, but they were a warrior people. And that sort of conquered what was already there. So, but as it was the last culture, it's a culture that everybody talks about all the time. It is not the most interesting culture of South America. But here you see at Guanacoma, he did this drawing of a backstrap room, the backstrap room that we have just been learning how to weave on. And textiles had a very, very high status in pre-Columbian Peru, also in Mexico. They were actually, in the minds of people, more worthy than gold and silver and ceramics or whatever. It was textiles that gave status. And because of that, the way of making the textiles was exquisite, because there was time, there was money, there was everything into it. So they had a very, very, very rich tradition of textiles. This is an ancient loom, just like what we've been working on. So the Chimu culture, 12 to 1400. And the pattern down here is a weft pattern, like that I have done on the, like this. This is also a pattern done on the weft. It's just drawn really, or the weft, and then you have an extra pattern weft coming in. This is also from the Chimu culture. It is actually in the northern part. They were very, very skilled weavers. Also the people before them, that was all the, because of the climatic El Niño, which is this storms that come in and destroy and high floods and whatever. So the older cultures from there, the organic material, we don't have much of that. But we have a lot from the Chimu culture. This is made in tapestry. They did all kinds of techniques, all the ones that we have known here before the industrialization, and some more that we never used, apart from knitting. This is a work basket, and you see the people who were weaving were, the best weavers were what the Spanish called the nuns. It was women who belonged to the state, and they lived in an enclosure, and they wove all the textiles for the Inca. The other people who were weaving were the head of the provincial people, professional skilled male and female weavers also. But the finest ones were woven by the nuns. And everybody had her little basket. We have in the museum in Berlin, 145 of them. Actually, in Berlin, I should introduce the collection there. Is the largest collection of pre-Columbian textiles in Europe. We have about 10,000 fragments and big things. And this is mainly because they came over, there were some German businessmen who were working and living in Lima in the beginning of the last century. And it was a la mode, it was trendy at that time to collect archaeological material. And a special merchant, Mr. Gleitzer, he collected and sent to Berlin 40,000 objects in 1906. Then they forbade the Peruvians, they sort of thought, this is it. And since then it has actually been forbidden, but it has only been forbidden to export archaeological materials since 1976 by UNESCO. So there's a lot of grave robbery, there's a lot of selling to private people in
kinds of materials that they were using. The native cotton up there to the left, it's put into combs and then it's spun. The cotton was growing and is still in four different colors. This is not dyed. This grows in these different colors in Peru. Of course, they dyed also. And then there's the wool. The wool was the alpaca. They didn't have sheep, but they had different kinds of llamas, and the best one for wool was the alpaca. And they were master dyers. They of course, for the blues, used indigo and cochineal, which is this little lights on the cactus, for the red colors, and then there was a purple, which was the purpo, which the Romans also used. They had that in Mexico too. They still use it on the coast, and on these various greens and yellows from plants. This is a weaving from La Bayeque of two women who were spinning. And I can see that they're spinning wool because they're using a drop spindle. The cotton is spun vertically. You have it in a gourd and you spin it vertically. So you can read a lot from the textiles. This is also one of Pomarayana. And he's making drawings of the costumes of the Incas. Now we have to remember it's only the last 100 years. There is a lot of similarity to earlier cultures, but the ones that we have from Guanacoma is only from the Incas. This is the Inca himself. He's wearing a tunic in tapestry, which is covered by patterns, and he's wearing a manta, like a shawl. And then, of course, he has all these fringes and his headset. This is his wife, the Coya. The Coya is wearing a wraparound dress, which is fixed on the shoulders. This is not her breasts. This is actually the two pins that are holding it together. And then she has a shawl, and then she has another shawl on the head. This kind of dress was used only by the Inca, the wraparound. The earlier cultures, the women were also using tunics. There was a difference between the men's and the women's tunic, but they were all using different kinds of tunics. So this is a typical Inca costume. We have all these archaeological textiles from mummies, from 6,000 before Christ. People started to mummify their dead on the south coast of Peru. And they did that all the time until the conquest. It was not like in Egypt where you mummify a person and then it's placed inside the pyramid and he never comes out. They came out. They were taking part in parties, and I mean, you would take them out and take them around and you would visit them. And so they had like a large afterlife. The dead body is sitting like this, and then you're actually very small. And then it was wrapped, depending on the culture, in a number of textiles, usually in clothing, not strips like the Egyptians, but sort of in various clothing, and some cotton to pack you out and make you bigger. This cushion on top is a false mummy head, is what we call it. It's just a cushion full of plant material. And the mummified person is sitting inside here, right? Inside here. And you can see this sort of a rope, the structure around, and then you get all these more or less fancy clothing. The richer the person, of course, the more fancy the clothing is. This guy, for instance, this is interesting because it is symbols of replica feathers. They also had feathered textiles, and they were, of course, very, very expensive. I brought them that I will show you. But if you couldn't afford to have real feathered textiles, then at least you could weave them into your weaving so that it sort of gave something. All these little packages are full of plant materials, usually coca. They chew a lot of coca,
And you don't get high from chewing coca, but you can, it's like coffee. I mean, it gives you some power. You don't have to eat so much, you don't sleep, but you don't get, I mean, they used all kinds of drugs, plant drugs. But the coca is not one, it's not hallucinogenic or anything that you have to refine in many different ways. So, this is a woman's tunic, and it is woven, this is the warp, going in this direction, and then it's sewed on, it's like a tube. And then you have other pieces of material on top. Up here you have, oops, that was too early. This is in very bad shape, so you guys can see. But it has some pleats here and pleats here. And then what it has is that it has a horizontal neck opening, and also a horizontal opening here. The men's are always having vertical openings and vertical openings here. So you can always see, and this goes through all the cultures, we think, if it's a man's tunic or if it was a woman's. Most of the things that we find, the mummies are men. It does not say that, I mean, there were also very important women in some of the cultures. We have found, like, the high priestess of this and that, and whatever. So people also, women also had something to say. But most of them are still men, for some reason. So I suppose it was majestic too. This is an old one from the Nazca culture. It's a small tunic. I mean, the square form was used through all the cultures, but sometimes they were big like this. Sometimes they were down to here, out to here. Sometimes they were tiny. It sort of changed, fashion changes. And, so this one is a very short one. This is what the men were using at that time. And this has the patterns on it are weft. I mean, it's like what we were weaving. You have the warp and the weft, and then on top you have the patterns. We call it brocade. It's actually like embroidery, but it's done during the weaving. So this is also from the Nazca. This is a double weave. That means that you have two layers of warp, and you interchange them so that the red patterns here are white on the inside. And this one is a tapestry. It's a headband, a tapestry headband. So this was done to the one to the left. It's a cotton on this one. It has a cotton board inside it, but the patterns are made out of the alpaca. Actually, it's much easier to dye wool, also alpaca. Cotton is harder to dye, so all the ones with really flashy colors, they are wool. These are cotton. Talking about it, and you can see how different they are. It's sort of different cultures, and sort of in different places around the same time. But in some places, this Ixna one here, that was short until here, and the arms down to here. And the other one was more sort of square. This one was really long. This is from the South Cape. It's the one to the right. The pattern that you have up here, it's a bird. You can see the bird is looking that way, and then you have it sitting on its head looking the other way. And these little ones probably also have a meaning, but they're tupapus, and we think that they have, maybe it's a geographic thing, maybe it's a like what we have, the nobility, for instance, have certain signs. It's a little hard to know. This one is, again, it's a double weave, where it's white on the outside, it's brown on the inside. And this is one of the feathered textiles that I talked about. It's a normal cotton textile. It's actually woven with two panels. And then on top of it is sewn And these feathers, they were first tied on like long fringes. They were tied in and then they were wrapped on a comb. And then you had a comb with yellow and one with blue and one with red. And then you would sew them on the finished woven textile afterwards. These birds, most of them came from the tropics, because Peru is, it's desert along the coast, and then there's the mountains, the Andes, and then there is the jungle. And it was always like that. There was a lot of import from the jungle, and they would either import the feathers already taken off the birds, or they would import the birds and keep them in cages. What they also did, tapirage. Do you know what tapirage is? It's terrible. You take off the feathers of the birds and then you put in a little dye on their skin, and then they grow out in another color.
No.
So these ones are also done in the backstrap room, and this is a tapestry with this is the moon animal. This one is also a brocade. It's a little different. It's the same on the both sides. It's a double-sided brocade, and the strips on the top and on the bottom, they are only on the front side. This is from the south coast, and they're very well known for covering the textiles completely with the brocade, these tiny patterns. This is a woman's shawl that she was wearing on top of her head. And of course, you have to remember that all of this was plant dye, right? And you can see what colors they have. So the strong colors here, I think this green and the yellow and the red, that must be camelid or alpaca. And the other, the pink and the white, of course, the background, and the brown, purplish one, that's cotton. This is another, this is from a shroud to the left, and it's a woman who's barren. Of course, you can see she's having a baby. It's all in cotton. In general, most of the cultures, when they did tapestry, they did it in wool. But here in this culture, they do it in cotton also. And you can see it's the natural brown cottons, and then the indigo always. We have the oldest indigo dyed textile in the world, as far as I've understood, is from Peru. It's 6,000 BC. It's not woven, it's what is called half weaving. You have the warp strapped out, and then you, with two threads, you sort of put together, but you have no headlines yet. So it's before the weaving, but they could still dye. And of course, there was a lot of the textiles that were printed or painted or decorated in other ways. First woven, and then I have not been so interested because I'm in these printed and painted ones, because I find the techniques of the weaving so exquisite that has taken all my life. This is also from the central coast, pretty close to the Inka, and it's a short mave tunic, and it's in two different sides. On the front side it looks like this, and on the back side, or vice versa, it looked like that. And they did that a lot. So on the front side you had one, and on the back you had a totally different thing on. Now, this is also the same kind of weft pattern. And on the brown is, of course, always the cotton, the native cotton. So they also had another hat. Now, it's the same kind of loom, but they were a little different. This is, as you can see, it's the two sticks, and the handle of the shed has fallen out. But it's a small one, which is put on two poles so that it can stand somewhere, because otherwise you have to roll it up whenever. So this is standing fixed. And here, these are drawings of weavings, where you can see exactly that kind of a loom represented, right? And on this tiny loom, they were doing these patches that in this culture, it's a culture on the coast also, and they were not really high, well, there wasn't a high culture that controlled
they have a harder time having access to the camelid wool, because the camelids, they traditionally live out of the mountains, and the cotton grows down on the coast. And I think this is why they did these little patches, and then they sort of sewed it on a cotton, it's just my thought, on a cotton, woven piece of cotton. Also, these long straps here, and on the side you can do on this little loom, because you can just roll it up. It can, any kind of this actual loom, it has its limits. It cannot be wider than about 80 centimeters, because you have to be able to one person weave it down. But it can in principle be 3 kilometers long, because you can just roll it up from one side and from the other side, and then they sew it together. This is a very interesting kind of this baksha loom, and it is for weaving discontinuous warp and weft patterns. That means it's an example of how much they invested in finding really difficult techniques that they could use. And in this technique, in a tapestry, you have a warp all the way, and then you have pieces of weft, right, to do the tapestry. But here you also have it with the warp. So you don't put up a warp the whole way. You make all these sticks or threads or whatever in between, and then you make one warp that goes from here to here, another one that goes from here to here, another one that goes from here to here. And then you weave in, you can see there where you don't have it, it's because it's another color that will come in here. And then what you get out of that is pieces like these ones, where you can weave thin material, which is exactly the same color on the front and on the back. Actually, a thin material, you could also print it. But here they knew that this was made in this very, very difficult technique, and therefore, of course, it was a very, very prestigious kind of textile. For doing these textiles with the little squares, sometimes the squares are under this 1 centimeter or something like that, and they would not have sticks in between, they would have threads so that the warp was not looped into each other. And after they have been, I don't know if it's weaving, because you also, it's more like sewing, right? Because there's not really space for the sheds. And one theory is that after they had finished such a textile, they would pull out the threads between them, it would all fall apart, and they would have all these little squares that they would dye in different colors, and then they would sew them together. But it's like, I remember in Guatemala, there's one village where the men, they have a wide belt. It's like this, and then it's 2.5 meters long. Then they put it on, and you can't see any of it, because it's really crumpled in, and on the last part, there's a lot of patterning. You almost can't see it, but you know it's there. So you don't have to sort of... This is also the same kind of technique, where you can see you have one warp going from here to here, another one is going, or a bunch of them going there, and then you weave in the other side, so that each color is woven by itself. This then, the warp and the weft, they interlink so that it doesn't fall apart when you take it out. And it's very thin material. It's amazing. So they also did have other kinds of looms. They had this horizontal loom, which is basically the same thing. It's just hung up, you know, so that it's square. And as you can see, this is one of Homa again, and this is sort of the way that the monks were treating the women who were weaving. They were weaving on that same kind of a loom. What they did was, in the other cultures earlier, actually also in the Inca culture, they turned it around so that the warp, if you imagine that the warp would be here, and it would be very, and there would be more people, it would be like this. this would be the shape, right? And there could be more people weaving at the same time. And these were always the, this was the Wari culture from 400 to 800 after Christ, and the Inka culture that used that kind of a loom, and it was always made in a cabinet. They never used that for a cup. This is one of the ones from the Wari culture, and they were very, very exquisite weavers. This one, for instance, it has 100 wefts per centimeter. So you can imagine, I mean, it's not silk, but their cotton was not as fine, it was more short fiber than the Egyptian one, but the wool, this wool, especially from the vicuña, which is another sort of the lamoid camelid, was very, very fine and very, very long, and supposedly they spun the finest woolen yarns ever. And like I said, they have to be really thin in order to pack 100 of them on one centimeter. This is the finest one actually that we have in Berlin, so I have to show it to you. This is the same culture as everybody can see. And in this culture, this is very interesting, they always do these two people. You have one person here, which is a warrior, and this is the shaman. He has wings on because he's taking all kinds of drugs and then he's flying. He has his hat on, he has his staff, which is a staff of status, sort of shows that he has a lot of status. And notice this eye, which is black and white, and then he has this sort of teardrop down here. Then he has his sort of sitting with his one knee bent over here. These are trophy heads, which are cut off people's heads that they were adorning themselves with all the time. And the other one is the warrior. It's the same, he has the same kind of eye, black and white, with sort of the teardrop, as I say, the mouth here, and the nose, and the profile. He has a bow and arrow in one hand, and a trophy head, a large trophy head. Maybe these ones were not real trophy heads, but just symbols of them, because definitely it's a trophy head. So, this is the same pattern, it's just abstracted. And it's really abstracted, and it's abstracted according to certain rules. I always thought that until the 20th century, abstractions was something that we just recently found out in art, but it's not. I mean, if you look here, you can see, this is the eye, black and white with the teardrop. This is the bent leg. And if you look at this square, it is two different patterns. You almost can't see the other, but it's sort of a step fret pattern with a volute. Just a, it doesn't mean anything. But then it is changed in this mirror. This is the same as this one, and this one. So according to certain rules, it's mirrored, and it's mirrored up and down, and we have a lot of these textiles, so we can see that there's a rule in it, and it was very, very definite the way that it was changed. These are also woven on an upright loom, and a white one, like I was showing before. These are Inca textiles, and what the Inca did was they simplified everything. Everything is minimalized. In a lot of the other cultures, there was persons and flowers and all kinds of things, but the Inca sort of reduced the whole thing to ornamentation. And of course we have this is a warrior. This is a soldier's coat. This one. We know that from Ramampomanayala, who has been describing them. We know everything from Ramampomanayala. This whole book, by the way, is in the library, the Royal Library in Denmark, and nobody knows how it got there. But 1902 1906 or something, somebody found it, because it was supposed to go to the emperor or the king of Spain, and he must have given it. I don't know, now it's one of our largest treasures, because that is where we have all the knowledge, the most knowledge of the pre-Columbian Inca culture anyway. And we also know a little about these patterns from here. For instance, the zigzag is because it's for a noble soldier belonging to the Inca. This is also typical Inca pattern. This is another Inca. It's a short one. It's from the southern coast. And this is made in discontinuous weave. You can see there's the light brown, and then there's the other one underneath. And then you have all these, it was woven on this side, so you have a warp that goes to here, and then on the other side you have the light brown, and then the rest is tapestry. And you have the same Inca, this is called the Inca key. It looks like a slit, which I don't know what you call it in English. And we see that repeated. We have no idea what it means. I mean, people have all kinds of ideas of what it means, but nobody really knows. So, now that we know all the pre-Columbian textiles, we go to the contemporary. They do them in exactly the same loom. They use this loom in China, in Indonesia, Thailand, many, many places in the world still. And this, on this loom, because everything is handmade, you can make anything. Other looms are sort of, they get faster, but then they can only do not so many different things. You can make anything you want on such a bachelor loom. And these ladies, it's from Chinchero that Papi and I and Sam visited this co-op workshop. And this one is from there, the shop. And it's a very special place. What has happened in Latin America, especially in Mexico, is that in order to survive, the people want to sell all these textiles to the tourists. And the tourists don't want to pay so much money for it. And I mean, I know this one that I made myself. It took me 3 months. And if it's hand woven, hand spun, it takes 6 months to do it. So it's, I mean, it's very, very slow to do that. And of course, the prices go up. So if you can't get that price, then you make them a little sloppy. You make them a little faster. You know, dye your yarns yourself. You buy them and add them and whatever. And they sort of deteriorate. Here, in this place, they've done the opposite, actually. They have, it's a co-op that had existed for, I don't know, but many years, 20, 30 years. And they have really done the opposite. They have started to recuperate the old ways of doing their textiles. They plant dye everything. Here they're doing their plant dyeing in their two little bowls there. And the ones you see up there to the left is cochineal, the red one too. I mean, you mix it in different, with different kinds of mortars, and then you get different colors. And with the other ones are probably mixed with some yellow giving flavored flowers, so you get the yellow and the green. You also have the purple. I don't think they use it up there, but that is also this purple color. They use that still down by the coast. And they're also spinning themselves. So they're really sort of making quality work. And it works. They have some people there that are working with them who knows how to sell these textiles, not only there for the tourists who come, but actually online all over the world. And it's not easy, but they do survive from that. Plus, they teach all the villages around, they teach all the children the traditional way of weaving, the traditional way of dyeing and spinning and everything. So they're sort of recuperating the culture that was almost not being forgotten, but it was deteriorating. I don't know if this happens in Mexico and Guatemala also, but I hope that it does. It did not when I was there 30, 40 years ago, then it was really on the way down. But as far as I have read, there are lots of co-ops in Mexico, and there are people who are willing to pay what it takes. I mean, if it takes you 3 months to do a textile, you should not bargain. Please, don't ever do that if you go around in the world. Pay the price. Because otherwise they're going to disappear. So, this is an old lady from the same co-op.